This is a module on gene regulation. It's an overview of the control of gene expression in prokaryotic cells, to be followed by a module on control of gene expression in eukaryotes. Cells regulate their metabolism and the level of the different metabolites, that is, different molecules in the cell, by controlling the activity of enzymes that produce or degrade them. And you may recall allosteric regulation, feedback inhibition, and so on, occurring using allosteric effectors as signals of cellular health, either speeding up or slowing down appropriate reactions in the cell by changing the shapes of the enzymes in various biochemical pathways. In this module and the next, we're going to focus on the control of gene expression, that is, the regulation of metabolite levels by regulating the amount of transcription of the genes that code for the enzymes themselves. So we're going to be looking at the control of the absolute amount of enzymes in a cell, that is, the absolute amount of transcript in the cell that can be transcribed by ribosomes to make the various enzymes and proteins needed. Let's focus then on gene regulation in prokaryotes. Remember now, these, of course, are all single-celled organisms. And these cells will regulate their genes in response to changes in environment, changes in nutrient concentration, or other factors in the environment, including toxic substances. And you may recall that genes are organized often in operons, or groups of three or more genes, that allows for their coordinated regulation. The genes in an operon are typically all involved in some aspect of the same biochemical pathway. Just briefly, gene regulation in eukaryotes typically involves changes that are programmed into the organism's cells as they grow and develop and as the multicelled animal becomes more complex. Of course, eukaryotes also respond to environmental change and also to chemical signals. In most cases, the chemical signals we respond to are actually inside our bodies. They include things like hormones and neurotransmitters. So now, prokaryotic gene regulation. The first thing is to define two kinds of genes that we think of. We think of the regulated genes, and these are the ones that are turned on or turned off in response to particular environmental signals or stresses, versus constitutive genes, and these are genes that are on all the time. We can imagine many genes that have to be on all the time. These would be genes that code for enzymes, for example, in glycolysis or in the Krebs cycle. The cell doesn't, if it's an aerobic cell, it doesn't stop breathing at any time. It controls the amount of glycolysis or Krebs cycle reactions taking place, as you may recall, in response to the need of the cell for energy, the amount of ATP, the amount of ADP, or the amount of metabolites that are indicators of the cell's activity in respiration. So we're going to focus on the regulated genes, and the first one we'll look at, or first ones we'll look at, should be familiar to you, those of the lac operon or lactose operon. This is a three-gene operon. These three genes are important in metabolizing the sugar galactose. It's a disaccharide. One of the two sugars is glucose, and the other is galactose. So here we have a cartoon of the lac operon's genes that code for three enzymes involved in metabolizing lactose. This operon is transcribed as a single long mRNA encoding the three genes that are these enzymes in the same pathway. Let's look at the transcription itself. It includes now a few other components. It includes the promoter, which is the sequence in front of the first of the three genes, which is actually the binding site for the enzyme RNA polymerase. There is also a gene that historically was called the I gene. It is a regulatory gene, and we'll see its function in just a moment. So here we have transcription of the lactose operon and the three genes in the transcript itself with three translation start sites. So what's going to happen here is ribosomes are going to assemble at three different points on this mRNA. The ribosomes are going to move along the message, along each of the genes, and transcribe the Z, the Y, and the A protein. Now let's finally look at the regulation of the lac operon. There are several modes of regulation. Let's look at the induction of the lac operon, meaning turning it on. This occurs by a process called derepression. So here we have lactose operon with a molecule of RNA polymerase shown in green sitting on top of the promoter. You might expect this RNA polymerase, having bound to the promoter, to start moving to the right through the operator and into the Y, Z, and A genes, transcribing the entire operon. But instead, there is a gene called the repressor protein gene, or the I gene that I mentioned a moment ago. The protein that it codes for is an active repressor protein, and now we'll see when it is transcribed and translated. It sits on the operator and literally blocks movement of the RNA polymerase past its binding site on the promoter, and so you get no transcription. That means this operon will be inactive most of the time. When will it be active? It will be active when there's lactose around. So what that means is E. coli, as you may recall from other classes, E. coli would prefer to use glucose as an energy nutrient, but at times glucose might be limiting in the environment, and there may be some of this milk sugar, that's what lactose is, milk sugar around instead. And E. coli can use lactose as an alternative to glucose. It's not as efficient. Remember, lactose has one glucose molecule and one galactose molecule. The E. coli cell would have to expend a fair amount of energy, first of all splitting the lactose into the two sugars, galactose and glucose, and then converting galactose into a usable sugar. So it would prefer to use glucose. But if there's limiting glucose around, this sort of thing might happen. If lactose is present, a small amount gets in the cell and a substance called allolactose is made, and that's the sugar you just saw, moving into the region of the gene and binding to the repressor, and by binding to the repressor, it causes an allosteric change, change of shape, change of conformation, and the lactose repressor protein becomes unbound from the operator, and at that point, the RNA polymerase can begin transcription, and you see here the formation of a YZA transcript. Let's take a look now at positive regulation of the lac operon by cyclic AMP. We're going to see the logic of that in just a second. If glucose is actually limiting, or if it's gone, the E. coli cell responds by synthesizing cyclic AMP. And the cyclic AMP binds to a protein in the cell called cap protein, or cyclic AMP binding protein. When cyclic AMP is bound to the cap protein is now an active gene regulator, an active activator of transcription, so let's watch what happens. Here's our RNA polymerase sitting on the promoter. Now, there is lactose in the environment, and a small amount of allolactose has been made, and this gene is moderately active in transcription. But look what happens when glucose is really absent, and there isn't any choice but to use lactose. Cyclic AMP goes up, cap protein becomes active, and binds to the operator, but in this case, the binding to the operator facilitates the initiation of transcription by RNA polymerase, and you get heavy-duty transcription of the gene, in other words, high levels of lac gene transcript being produced, so that the galactosidase protein and the other enzymes that are produced by the three genes are elevated. One is a galactoside permease, which increases the rate at which lactose can be brought into the cell. The permease is a facilitated transport protein. So when glucose is present and lactose is present, the gene is on, but to a moderate extent. When glucose drops to very low levels, the cells detect this, produce cyclic AMP, activate the cap protein, and increase transcription of the lac operon so the cell can really utilize lactose in the environment. So that's the regulation of the lac operon. We know a little bit about how cap works. Cap protein sits in DNA near the Z gene in this promoter region, and because of its shape, you saw it's sort of a roundish shape, it actually intercalates into the double helix and causes the entire double helix to bend. You might ask, what's the significance of the bending? And if you think about it for a moment, and you can actually duplicate this with plastic models or other kinds of models, if you bend a double helix, you will actually disrupt the hydrogen bonds between the bases and weaken that interaction, and that would result in an easier access of RNA polymerase and other proteins that might be necessary to get transcription going. And again, the cap protein, to be active and to have a high affinity for DNA, has to be bound to cyclic AMP. Let's look at repression of the TRIP operon. This is the operon. This is a 5-gene operon. Genes 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 code for enzymes in the pathway, the metabolic pathway, by which a cell can synthesize the amino acid tryptophan. And it's illustrated here as A going to B going to C going to D going to E, finally going to tryptophan, with the enzymes shown as 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The tryptophan operon also has an associated repressor gene. And here in this illustration, to start with, we show that the repressor gene is again being transcribed and translated and producing a repressor protein. In this case, the repressor protein is inactive. I neglected to mention, by the way, in talking about the repressor gene associated with the lac operon, that it, as well as this repressor protein gene for the trip operon, these are genes that are active all the time, meaning their repressor proteins are always around. So these repressor protein genes are not regulated. They produce gene regulatory proteins, but the genes are really themselves constitutive genes. They're on at all times so that they can interact with metabolites and thereby control the transcription of genes making enzymes that produce the metabolites. Okay, so here we have that operon with the repressor gene off to the left, the repressor protein present, but in this case, it's not active. There's our RNA polymerase. I have it seated underneath the operon instead of on top of it. And here we have the reaction. When tryptophan accumulates to excessive amounts, that is, when the cell has enough tryptophan, some of the tryptophan molecules can actually go and bind the inactive repressor and activate it, change its shape. By changing its shape, the repressor protein has now a stronger affinity for the operator and binds to it very strongly. And again, when this repressor binds to the operator, just as with the lac repressor, the RNA polymerase cannot move forward. It's blocked from transcribing, and transcription is repressed. In this case, tryptophan is referred to as a co-repressor because it is part of the molecule complex, the repressor tryptophan complex, that binds to the operator. And that brings us to the end of this presentation.